Hit that first one.
There you go.
There you go.
Amen. Amen.
Okay,
Amen.
go in, Minister Rose. You're live.
I am Minister Rose Christine Jackson. I'll be your instructor for tonight. And any music that is playing, we do not own the rights to any of it. So please enjoy the praise and worship until we get started. Amen.
Amen. Hold up. Might as well go to this next song then. Yes, God.
Money on the list, maybe now you're rich, and no one can tell.
Yes.
All the pain that you hide with
no fear.
Hallelujah.
Nothing but
amen. Thanks. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Oh, love
praise
you. Love
God
you.
For another Saturday night Bible study. And once again, I am Minister Rose Christine Jackson. I'll be your instructor for tonight. So let us go ahead and bow our heads in a word of prayer before we open up. Oh, Heavenly Father, oh, gracious God, we come to you on tonight, oh, God. Lord, we're asking you to come on in this place, oh God. Come on in this virtual classroom, oh God. Lord, we ask that you will be in the midst of us, oh God, in the mighty name of Jesus, Lord. Come in and join with us, oh God. Open up our hearts and mind of understanding, oh God, that we may learn from you, oh God. Lord, I thank you and I praise you, oh God, that we not just learn, but bring things back to our remembrance, oh God. So help us, oh God, that we will be able to go out, oh God, and to help others, oh God, as well as taking them and letting the word feed us and bringing us higher in you, Lord. And we just thank you and we praise you and we glorify you, oh God. And we just thank you for all things, Lord. We ask in the mighty name of Jesus that you will touch those that have viewed this on social media later, oh God. Touch their hearts and their minds that they may understand your word, oh God, that they may grow, oh God, and that they will go higher and higher in you, oh God, that they may be that light and that witness, oh God. And we just thank you and we praise you and we glorify your name, oh God. In Jesus' holy and righteous name, we do pray. Amen and amen. Praise
amen.
God. Praise God.
Amen.
I thank you. Praise God. Hallelujah. For another Saturday night Bible study, the opportunity to come before you all and just get into the word of God and let it, you know, let us learn and let it penetrate in us. Hallelujah. That we may be all that God has called us to be. Amen. 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 Praise God. My subject for tonight is walk worthy of our calling. Do you really know what that means? Amen. Our key scriptures are Ephesians 4, 1 through 2. I keep saying myself, do you really know what to mean? But actually it says, do you really know how to walk? But I keep thinking to myself, you know, do you really know what it means? But actually, if you don't know what it means, you don't know how to even walk. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. And that'd be Ephesians 4, 1 through 2, and Philippians 1, 2 through 7, 1 Thessalonians 4, 1, and 1 John 2, 5, and 6. Amen. Amen. And we may not get into all those scriptures on tonight, but I do want to go to, if someone to read Ephesians 4, beginning at the first verse, and then to go down to the third, and then we're going to jump over to the back to the second chapter of Ephesians in the 10th verse. And if we get any further, I will have somebody to read Colossians 1, 10 through 12. So right now, we're going to get started here. This says, in Ephesians, Paul teaches on the fundamentals of living godly life. He stressed that you are to walk in a manner worthy of the calling for which you have been called. The word walk has to do with behavior. It refers to daily conduct, to how living godly day by day. The word worthy means balance, the scales. The believer who walks in a manner worthy of call with which he has been called is one whose daily life corresponds with the blessing, our position as a child of God and fellow heir with Jesus Christ. Amen. Can I get someone to read Ephesians 4? And I want to go to 1.
Ephesians 4, 1 and 2 is what you said.
One through three is actually I want you to go to read, but I have
okay. From the Amplified, it reads, so I, the prisoner for the Lord, appeared to you to live a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called. That is to live a life that exhibits godly character, moral courage, personal integrity, and mature behavior. A life that expresses gratitude to God for your salvation. With all humility, forsaking self-righteousness and gentleness, maintaining self-control with patience, bearing with one another in unselfish love. Make every effort to keep the oneness of the Spirit and the bond of peace, each individual working together to make the whole successful. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Mm-hmm. Praise God. God, can I get someone to read Ephesians 2 and 10 real quick? Amen.
I've got it, Minister Rose.
Okay.
I am coming out of the King James Study Bible, and you said chapter 2, verse 10?
Yes.
Okay. And so right here, 10, 10, 10. Six, seven, eight. Therefore, remember, oh, that's 11. Oh, here we are. I'm so sorry. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them.
Man, I'm going to read that out of the Amplified Bible, because it says, for we are his workmanship, his own master work and work of art, created in Christ Jesus, reborn from above, spiritually transformed, renewed, ready to be used for good work, which God prepared for us beforehand, taking path which he set, so that we would walk in them, living the good life which he prearranged and made ready for us. Amen. Amen. And it's always good to get it out of two versions. I like our pastor, yeah. He's always like three people to read out of different versions. But here we have before us Paul explaining and teaching us the fundamentals of a godly living. So here I ask you, what are the characteristics of a worthy walk? Someone tell me, what are the characteristics of walking worthy? Anyone? What are the characteristics of someone who is walking worthy? But Bud, I see his hand up. Then I see Sister Gina's hand. Okay, Brother Bud, go right ahead. Brother Bud?
Unmute yourself, Brother Bud.
Sorry, I do that all the time. First of all, is making sure that your conscience is clear before God. As you look in the mirror, you see who you are, and you examine yourself daily, the Bible says. And then by studying and meditating on the word, that there's no way that the word lies. And if you're not lined up with the word, then you know that you got to change. So those are the couple of things that you have to do. And then pray it up, by praying that God will keep you in line and where you're supposed to be. And that's what walking worthy is, being able also to take that word, what you learned, and share it with others.
Amen. Sister Gina?
Oh, I've been dealing with, Dad's dealing with me right now. Really, really, I think really it's the gifts of the Spirit, is that it is, he wants us to be more like him. So walking in love, that love, gentleness, kindness, joy, patience, peace, because that is us being a good ambassador for Christ, to show him what Christ is in us. He wants us to walk in love and show our light to everyone else. So I think if we are walking with love and peace and joy, gentleness and kindness, then we are walking in a right standing with God.
Amen. Anyone else? The question is, what are some of the characteristics of walking worthy? Anyone? No one? Okay, well, I'm going to name some of the ones that I have down here, and it says we must be willing to live opposite lives of the world. We must not live in self-centeredness, in order to walk in humility. We must not live with harshness in order to walk with gentleness. We must not live pushing our own agenda in order to walk with patience. We must not live with idealistic expectations in order to walk in forbearing love. We must not live with indifference and passivity in order to maintain the unity of the spirit in the bond of peace. Amen. And basically, you both said basically the same thing, because you're talking about love, walking in love and walking in patience and walking in peace. So that's, you know, are some of the characteristics. And I wanted to see what people, how they think, how will their impact. Because a lot of people think that walking worthy of the Lord is just by going to church every Sunday. Some people think that doing a good deed is walking worthy. You know, Apostle Kim, did I see your hand up?
Yes, I was just going to say Ephesians 4, 1 gives you basically the answer to what you were just asking.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that's what I just,
Amen.
That's what I read, and I wanted to see what people got out of the reading. You know, a lot of times people read stuff and don't, you know, really get anything out of it. So when I read that, that's what I had in mind. That's why I asked the question, and that's it. It tells basically what it is, Ephesians.
Mm-hmm.
In the words that, the scripture that we read, and generally, those scriptures right there will tell you exactly how to walk worthy if you pay attention to those scriptures. Amen?
Yes.
So it says, since we have read all that, therefore let us walk worthy of the calling we have been received. What is the calling that we have received? I mean, I know that a lot of times that there are a lot of people have calling on their lives, but what God has called us in general to do. Because a lot of people think that they just supposed to go to church and that's it. No more, nothing less. Amen. Apostle Robert, men, Brother Bud.
Well, God has called us to go ye into all the world to spread the gospel to those that are lost and those that are, excuse me, bent and broken. So that's what we were called here on earth to do, is to spread the gospel to people that don't know about Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Brother Bud and then Apostle Kim.
Well, praise God. She took the whole answer almost. That's exactly what we're here for, is to spread the news. God came here to touch our lives so that we could reach out and touch other people, especially the ones that nobody wants anything to do with. That's the one thing that I've really learned in my life. It's the ones that, you know, are thrown by the wayside, you know, the Good Samaritan that comes by and puts somebody up and gives them pays for their rent and everything and bandages them up and stuff like that. Showing love is real love, not just because you're popular or anything like that. I'm just going to say something else, but that went the same way it was going to go. So it had to, sharing the word of God and be an example. That's, I guess, what the word I was going to say. Be example to others to see that it's not just going to church, but it's your lifestyle living for Christ.
Amen.
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 You know, Apostle Robin, again, you have your hand up, and then
Apostle
Kim had something.
Yeah, I wanted to add. Amen. Thank you, Apostle Kim. Excuse me. It made me think of when Brother Bud was talking. You know, why do we struggle sometimes with sharing the word with people that are lost? You know, because, you know, you find a lot of times where, you know, you got alcoholics, you know, the drug addicts, you know, people that, you know, really need a helping hand. And there are times that we frown on it, You know, I'm finding more and more white. You know, just kind of, you know, that just kind of hit my spirit that, you know, we can frown on those, and then sometimes we forget from where we came from, because we all have a past. Amen.
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 Man, it's so true. A lot of times, we do as Christians. I have seen it done so many times. We frowned on those people, and I wonder my, you know, the same thing. Why do we frown down on them? I've seen where they have put them out the church when they have come into the church. Obviously, they come in there to get fed, to get, you know, something. They do something. They want to change, but yet we turn around and we put them out the church and doing wrong and everything, and it's just, it has been horrific. I've seen it so many times when I was living in Missouri, back in St. Louis, Missouri, and it just grieved my spirit, because they used to say the church was the spiritual hospital, but now that it's not. You don't see nobody getting healed spiritually most of the time in the church, and I'm not talking about naturally. A lot of people, you know, a lot of times they individual faith, they do get healed, but I know I haven't seen nobody. A lot of times people come into, I'm not gonna say I don't see, wipe out that statement, because it's many people getting healed spiritually. I just want to say that the thing is, they come into the church and they need a spiritual healing, but instead, I still see your hand, Apostle Kim. I'm not gonna forget about you. They need a spiritual healing, but yet the people are not, they're not discerning the spirit that of their what their needs are, and they come in and go back out the same way they came in. It shouldn't be. If all of us that's in there supposed to have this same Christ that's within, ooh, that's supposed to be, and we're supposed to be within Christ Jesus. How in the world that we let people go in and out of the church, and we don't allow them to get spiritual healing? We're supposed to, you know, to be that, what word I want to use?
Example.
We said we're supposed to be that example, and we supposed to come to
Beacon of
them.
light.
We're supposed to be that light, and but we're no more lights. We look down our nose at them. Go ahead, Apostle. I make you lose your thought.
Yes, that's what I was just thinking about, how we want to pick and choose who we want to help instead of
Exactly.
allow God to be God by himself. Because the church is a hospital, and everybody that comes in the building and need some kind of help from the physician, none of us are exempt. Because we all coming from something. God brought us out of something. We are ex something. So none of us are exempt. And we try to put people in a position we ourselves don't want to be put in. What about when people have been in our midst and we start shielding them? We put up blockers. Who's to say if God did that to us, will we be able to help anybody? Who are we?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Elder Marshall, and then Brother Bud.
God bless. You
Bless.
know, sometimes people don't want to go to. Sometimes people don't want to be healed. They just want to come and get entertained. No, I understand. You understand that people, the church is supposed to be the healing place, but some people just come inside to worship the God of House just to be saying, I attended a fellowship. They're not coming to get healed. So, I understand your point. Yeah, sometimes we do shine people away. But sometimes people just don't want to be healed. They stuck. They stuck just the way they are. Just like we was discussing earlier. People do not want to be, some people don't want to be helped. They say you can't help nobody if they don't want to help themselves.
That's
if people don't want to change, they're not going to change. People come, they come in just to be nosy. They come in just to want to see what's going on inside the building. They just want to get entertained. They're not coming to get healed. But yes, we do have individuals that we have shunned away. I remember one day I missed the opportunity to witness. And it killed my spirit because it hurt my, I ain't gonna say killed. It hurt my spirit because God wasn't pleased with me at that opportunity, at that moment, because I didn't pass the test. This individual came in and sat next to me on the pew. Instead of me introducing myself to the individual and talking to the individual, I missed the opportunity because I was focusing on the word instead of focusing on that opportunity to witness, and I missed that opportunity, and God wasn't pleased, and my spirit was hurt. So sometimes we miss opportunities to witness to people, but sometimes people just don't want to be healed. I just wanted to put that out there.
Amen. I understand that as well too, but you're right. There's time people do want to be. It's so many times that we miss the fact that people do come in that want to be healed. But you and I agree with you. A lot of times people don't want to be healed and think a lot of that and get mad if you come to them and try to say something to them about it. Amen. Apostle Kim and then Brother Bud.
Okay. Amen. I was just going to say that. Oftentimes, we expect to see a change instantly. All changes, all growth don't happen immediately. Some happen over time. And we can be impatient before the time. We want to put pluck it before it's time. Okay. Just because you don't instantly see a change does not mean change have not occurred.
That's true.
Amen?
Okay. Amen. Amen. That's so true too. But then I understand though that at times that that's what go on. But then also, like I said before, it's so many that don't get, you know, the change. It's so many of them because they don't get fed when they come to church. I'm gonna just be real with you. Now it's a lot of people that I know just go to church to be going to church, and they get a sermon, I wouldn't even call it a sermon. They get a what you would call a lecture. You know, they get a motivated lecture. That's all, motivation. Nothing to do with God and nothing to do with, you know, being my brother's keeper or anything like that. It's more or less a motivated speaker how to get to achieve more into the world. Basically, that's all without God, without the word. Brother Bud, and then Minister Isaiah.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Well, it was muted again. I got three things I wanted to say. It's like the prodigal son. You have to go to the bottom of the barrel before you realize what you had. And then the second one is like the weeds and the briars. When we first had what we had and we allowed things to come into our life, it literally will choke out your life. And then the third is the testimony that we have, whether it be alcoholic or whatever it is, that we have been there and have the ability to say, hey, you know, I'm not there no more. And you don't have to, you know, this hope is for you, you know, because God did for me. I'm not any better than you, you know, no matter what, if I maybe have a nice shirt on or something and the other person's, you know, it's just like, you know, you gotta be the example. You gotta to be a hunger for souls. That's another thing before, you know, things can happen. Okay. That's it. Thank you.
Amen. Welcome. And God bless you, brother. But Minister Isaiah?
Man, I see a few things in there. I agree with Elder Marshall. So that where I had opportunities and I seen somebody hurting and I didn't take step up and talk to that individual. And when they left, I stopped feeling bad because that's the opportunity to use God's word to talk to the individual. Maybe I could have helped. So I dropped the ball a lot of times on that. And I think Kim said, everything don't happen overnight with some people. And that, remember I said yesterday about process? Some people need to process. And three, when we talk about people don't want to be healed and saved, I go back to, remember Christ said, your faith heals you too. So if I come to church, I'm just coming up there and say, well, let me go up there and see if I get some blessing from you. And nothing happened because you just went up there for that show. Your heart wasn't in it. Your faith wasn't in it. So you're not going to receive no healing because you didn't come up there for no healing. You just came and went up there for the show. There's a lot of ways you can go with this stuff, you know?
Amen. Amen. That's true. People, I think that in the church, and you know that very well, that where people don't want to be healed. And there's people that's in leadership that don't want to be healed. And they and you know they got some kind of idea that they're not going right. They're not doing right. I mean, so many people tell them that, but then they look at it, oh, that's them. That's the other person. I don't need spiritual healing. You know, Mr. Isaiah, you know, we just left a church that's like that. But yeah, the word of God coming to them all the time, but they throwing it back out like it's somebody else. So yeah, it is. It's so many that they don't want. They don't want that spiritual healing. You have something to say, Minister? See, you unmuted yourself again. Minister Isaiah, nothing.
No, I'm go ahead.
Oh, okay. But yeah, you're so true. It's a lot of times we do miss out on a witness. And I have been there a lot, many a times when God has gave me the opportunity to witness somebody, I miss out on that witness because a lot of times I'm so focused on something else, like Elder Marshall said. Elder Marshall was sitting, you know, he was focused on the word when it was the opportunity right next to him to be able to be a witness. We're supposed to focus on the word, but yet, you know, we got to have we know that we're supposed to always look into the Lord. But this right here, over here, is part of the Lord's too. We got to have our rear view mirrors on, our side view mirrors on when we walking with the Lord, because we might miss out on our opportunity. We might miss
That's
out
good.
On our blessing that God has for us. Amen. We have quite
That's
a few
good.
Messages in the chat, and I'm going to go to the chat and try to read them. Pinch. Righty. We have okay. All right. Who said this? Y'all, I'm working with a new device, so bear with me because this is new to me. If I can get somebody to read the thing till I can get used to to this device. Can somebody read what's in the chat, please? Hey, man, nobody willing to read?
Trying to get to it.
Thank you, Sister Janet.
Okay. Let's see where we go here. All right. Well, we've got quite a few. Okay, Kim Bolden said to everyone, amen, Ephesians 4, 1 through 2. Kim, Apostle Kim, Ephesians 4, 1 through 3, Amplified, so I, the prisoner for the Lord, appeal to you to live a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called.
I think that was, she was reading the scripture that
I was going to read it again. Okay, a life corresponding to faith that we confessed in Christ by sorely dependent on the spirit of truth. That was Apostle Thibault. First, it's a call to come, carry our cross, to follow him, and that define the place of our encounter. Secondly, to take the life of Christ to another in the power of the Holy Ghost, Amen. Witnessing and restoring. Pastor, Prophet Robin, come on, say that now. Minister Rose, yes, keep preaching. So true, beacon of light. Who are we to pick and choose the assignment God sends our way?
Amen.
Yes. Prophet Robin, yes, we can bring the horse to water, but we cannot make them drink. They truly have to want it for themselves. Yes. Apostle Kim, a lot of people have misunderstandings about the church, as well as we have to change their mindset about the church.
Amen.
Yes.
Very well. Very.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Apostle Thibault. Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Rose.
Go ahead.
Sometimes when the prophetic have an uncertain sounds, that's what I think it is the problem at most of the time. And I think we're caught up there, Minister Rose.
Okay. Apostle Tubbo, can you explain that statement you made about sometimes when the prophetic has an uncertain sound, that's what I think is the problem most
yes.
of the time? Elaborate on that.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Man.
First of all, I want to say sorry. I'm a bit late. I have a little challenge logging in. But thank God I got the link from the board. And glory to God, it's successful. Now, I was following the comment. I came quite late. So I was trying to go through the comment that I made. I saw the scripture, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1 to 3, Amplified Version. So when I read through, I was kind of okay replying to the scripture. And via what I heard from everyone speaking, especially the last, I don't know, Apostle K, when I heard people say, many are in the church or go to church and are in the church and they don't want to be healed. And we can't make them want to be healed, or we can't force them until they desire themselves for themselves. Now, I say sometimes when the prophetic, there's a error in this place, is when the prophetic gave an uncertain sound. That's what I think the problem was at the time. Now, this is it. When the message of truth is misinterpreted, is not passed across rightly, then we end up producing unbelieving believers, and which on the other side, we see them, they are the multitude, they are much in number than those that believe in the church. And so therefore we begin to see them making mockery of the church or the power of God for receiving healing and all of that, because the prophetic, which is talking about the gift of God now, the calling of God, is not being passed across rightly, then we cannot help but to see this kind of people in the church. And when we start seeing them, then mockery certainly will set in. Now, we see in the book of Acts chapter 4, where the church is started growing up, and certain people sold out, they pledged to sell some of their property and give to the church in order to reach out to others, okay? But all of a sudden, we see Sapphira and Ananias and Sapphira. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
When they came in, you see, they came in to mock the gospel now, because Paul or Peter had given a certain sound, not uncertain sound, a certain sound. And when this man came around, is this how much you sold these things? That's how much we sold it and all of that. Now, if God has not intervened at that time, then the first church will be made mockery of. And so a lot of people will come in and all manners of things. So that's what I mean by some people don't receive because the foundations they ought to receive, the foundation they ought to see is not there. So how can they build on a false foundation? And healing cannot take place on a false foundation. It has to be on the right foundation. John the Baptist was saying, I'm bearing witness of the Christ, of one coming after me. Now, he came to bear witness. Now, if his witness is not right, then nobody is coming. God is not coming to confirm anything because he can only come to confirm the truth. How be it when the spirit of truth will come? So he's not coming to speak of other things. So this is what I mean when the prophetic, the ministers, the pastors, the shepherd, when they are not giving a certain or when they are giving uncertain sound, then we cannot help but seeing all those things happening. Most of these people that are not receiving healing, it is not, most of them are innocent. Most of them are ignorant. So, and that is why as a minister, they have to set the right foundation that only God can come. Nobody have the power to heal anybody. Only God comes to heal. So if the ministers who have been sent forth to minister did not minister right, or they minister out of their philosophy and ideology, traditions of men, and all of that rudiments of the world, then we don't expect to see nothing but all these deficiencies in the church. So that's what I mean. When the prophetic give a certain sound, then I think that is where the problem is sometimes. Though I also know that there, no matter what you preach, no matter how true it is, some will still not accept. But largely, there are many who fall victim because the message we have passed across is not right. Praise the Lord.
Amen. 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 That's it. A lot of times that, you know, it's not right. Like you said, I will say the atmosphere is not right because the spirit of the Lord is not dwelling in there. So a lot of times you can't get healed and delivered. It made me think about, my mind went back to, I don't know if many of y'all heard of this, and I don't want to keep dragging it out. I ain't going to mention no name, but a young lady on YouTube, she went to a particular service expecting New Year's Eve to be fed because she said she wanted to do it the right way, just like her mom and her grandmother taught her to. But she said her first mind told her to go to club, but then it came to her, no, I want to do it the right way, like my mom and my grandma taught me to. So she went to church and she said she might as well have went to the club because that's what she got. The atmosphere wasn't right for what she wanted. She was looking for a church atmosphere to be fed by the word of the Lord. And so many times that it's not there. It's not there. And especially if the leader is not living the part, you cannot get healed. You know, God is not going to work through an unclean vessel. So I think a lot of times that we got to realize and understand we cannot sit underneath everybody's teaching. We cannot keep, you know, what I call church hopping. Because every church that you hop to is not necessarily a church of the true and living God. There are a lot of satanic churches out there. And like I said before, a lot of churches that's out there, they just churches that do motivational speaking. They're not feeding your soul at all. But they want to tickle your fancy and they want to tell you good things just to keep you coming back. And the spirit of the Lord is not in it at all. So we have to be careful of who we sit under. We have to sit under sound doctrine. And many of us do not sit under sound doctrine. And I was talking about this earlier with my God sister Patricia. You all know her. Most of you all do. But anyway, they had a topic saying that about, where they was talking about people going to church and not actually getting fed. And the thing is because the pastor's not being fed. The pastor don't have nothing in him to give to them. If you have been called and set aside to be a pastor or be a not necessarily even a pastor, you can just be called into the ministry and the Lord has assigned somebody up underneath you. You have to live by example. And how can you live by example if you don't even know the word? You're not even studying the word. I know this young lady that at one time she had, before she had got saved, she was saying, what does she need to go to church for when she was in the club and the pastor of a particular church was up in the club too? She said, what's the sin? So we have to, you know, be careful who we get to feed us. We got to be discerning, you know. I mean, especially us that's supposed to be called by his name, especially us that we know that the Lord has came into our lives and put in us this hidden treasure, this marvelous life. But then we turn around and go out and sit amongst so many other people that we know they're not living right. That we know, we see that they're not living right. What do it look like me that I've been in here teaching Bible study class? I pray on Thursday night, and then I go and join myself up with a harlot. That's what you're doing when you're doing the word of God. That's what he explains. That in the word of God is what we're doing. We can't do that. We have to walk worthy of the calling. We can't associate ourselves with people that we know that are living unrighteously, living wretched lives, that are not living for the Lord. That, you know, it's sad that people don't know that you're supposed to be saved. You know, it puzzled me because my aunt was telling me about somebody that she worked with all these many years. And then when she retired, you know, she got word that this person had passed away. And so she decided she was going to go to the funeral. And she said she went to the funeral and they was just preaching her all up in heaven and everything. And she was like, okay, are we talking about the same people, the same person? And the people was like, from the job that was still working with her, with this person, was like, what? They did not know that this person was supposed to say. Now, that is a crying shame when you don't work with people for years and you don't even know that they supposed to be saved. And then they used to have this joke out about people would be at the funeral of somebody and they talk about how good of a Christian they was and how they worked so hard in the church and all this. And it was funny. It was probably the woman was saying, oh, they talking about him so well and everything, and she had a child from this man. And in fact, it was probably her ex-husband, they talking about she asked her son, go up there and make sure that's your daddy they talk about, because we might be at the wrong funeral. So, you know, it's sad when things like this happen. We have to walk worthy. I mean, there's no way in the world that you're supposed to be saved, that you claim the Lord and you work in the church and you go to church on Sunday. You may even go on Bible study night, but people that you work with and then your neighbors have no idea that you're saved. You know, I don't know, this topic I have, and it asks a question about the question asks, do you really know how? Do you really know how to be saved, or do you really know what it means to be saved? That's the question, you know, I'm asking. See, walking worthy of your calling, before you can walk worthy of your calling, you got to know how to walk worthy of your calling, and you got to know what it is, and what it is and what it means. I see your apostle, Tabu. Go ahead.
Amen.
Amen.
Minister Rose, you're very correct, ma'am, when you said we should sit under a good teacher, or let me put it in this way, we should sit under Holy Ghost filled teaching environment. It is very true. When we sit or when we meet a good minister that have been, okay, sorry for that language, a good, when we meet a heart that is burning for Christ in the spirit of truth, we sat under their teaching, it helps us to grow faster, and it helps us get to where we are going, know the aims and objectives of the gospel. But at the same time, I think that we need to come, we need to have an encounter individually, both the minister and both the congregation. Now, why I say that, I use myself as a point, as an example. We grew up under people who don't have the truth. They know something, but what they know was contrary to the scripture. Totally. Okay, and we have been there for years. Okay, and we receive what they keep telling us. But that is not the truth. Then how do we come about the truth? It was when I had a personal encounter that I gave myself to fasting and prayer. I just know that there is more. But I don't know, maybe it was God calling out. But I just know that there is more to these things I'm hearing every day, every Sunday. There is more to this. I gave myself to fasting and prayer, to devotion, to study. Then that was when encounter came. Now, it is no longer them. They don't have to teach me, because he that teaches has not appeared. And if truly it is true that he is going to teach us into all truth, then I have to, once he teach me, it has to align with the scripture. But many of us, many believers, only sit under people to keep feeding them. They don't long for an encounter. Now, how can these people escape wrong teachings? How can they identify wrong teachings when all they need to do, all they want to do is just to sit under somebody and just keep telling us, you keep praying, Pastor, you keep doing the fasting, I just need to keep listening to you, no problem, it's okay for now. When we will give them, or when they will give them error, now they will not know. Many of them have been given orange and they eat the seed with the water. You see, and that is too bad. It is not too good. So sitting under sound teaching is very important. Of course, I love it. But that is not what God is calling every believer for. God is calling every believer to come and touch him. And this is why I so much respect the ministry of John the Baptist. Now, when Jesus came on the scene, he said, this is him of whom I was talking about. And immediately, some of these disciples left him. They left him and they follow on Jesus. Now, that's a good minister. Now, unlike this day, everyone wants to gather members to follow them and not pointing to Christ. Point Jesus. Follow Jesus. Now, not everybody wants to do that today. And look at the ministry of Apostle Paul. He has been sitting under the law for years, to in so much that he against the church. Now that shows us that he has been under a wrong teaching for years. A wrong teaching for years. And now when he encountered Jesus, when he encountered, now one of the things that defined his encounter was, he was a man who wants to know. God sees his heart that this man is fighting for what is right, but in the negative side. And Jesus had to appear to him and put him after the encounter. He never sat under anybody. It was encounter, and that is what Jesus is calling every Christian, every believer. This is where he's calling us, where we can come in contact with him one-on-one, beholding the Father. Praise the Lord. Praise the name of Jesus. So,
amen.
And talking about the calling, walking worthy of our calling. Now, do we really know how? To me, I believe it is number one. We need to allow ourselves. We need to yield ourselves before to God. Then let Him take us through. Many of us are running from process. Many believers run. They are running from process. And without process, then we can't get nothing at the end of the day. God wants to take every believer through process. And my own process is different from another person. Now, this might be facing this, another person facing this. Then that will be the Lord revealing to us. Apostle Paul run the race. Peter run the race. Philip run the race. Every one of them. They ran the race according to the encounter they had. Yet, they are still in the same church. To me, I think we just need to yield ourselves, humble ourselves, and we will get to know a little gradually as we grow. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Amen. Amen. Yes. Excellent. You know, that was well said. Apostle Abu. It's just, you know, It's like a lot of times that we don't realize that we need healing ourselves, and it's a lot of ministers that's out there that need healing spiritually and don't know how to walk in the calling. But you know, that's because of so many of them that has accepted a calling or either put a calling on themselves. You know, where the Lord hasn't called them. Because a lot of people are in this for monetary gain. They're not in here because they love souls. They're not in here because a lot of times, and a lot of us, we don't know how to walk worthy of our calling. And it's because we don't know the word of God. And it goes back to, we have to study to show ourselves approval. A workman needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And then we have to learn how to rightly divide the word of truth. How can you rightly divide the word of truth if you're not sitting underneath sound treatment, sound teaching? You know, you cannot if you're not sitting underneath sound teaching. You know, and I've seen it so many times in the past where people are sitting up underneath people, and it's just like they're not growing. They're not growing at all. And I don't understand, how can you sit somewhere and you're not growing? Because I myself, I got to get something out of going to church. I'm not just going to church to be going to church. And we find that so many times today that a lot of people, like somebody said before, that they just go to church because they know it's right to go to church, or either that because grandma or auntie, your mama, somebody taught them to go to church. We have to learn how to apply the word our lives, and we can't apply the word to our lives if nobody teach us. I think of the scripture that I believe that it was Jesus was walking on the road, or the Ethiopians was walking on the road, and they met Jesus after he had, you know, been crucified and everything and stuff, and he asked them, had they since they something about the word of God, and they said, how can we know if no one has taught us? Anybody know that's what I'm trying to say?
Yeah.
But if they didn't have nobody to teach them, they didn't have nobody to open up the word of God to them. And I know that it's times that people, because I know a couple people that were all alone and had never been to, they wasn't in nobody's church when the Lord spoke to them. and opening it up to them certain things. But it was things that they did have to go underneath the city of somebody. How can we hear without a preacher?
That's good.
How can they preach without man sent? You got to be sent. They got all of them work hand in hand. So therefore, you are not going to walk worthy of your calling because you don't know how. You understand? All of us need some kind of teaching. All of us need some kind of teaching. I don't claim to know everything. And I know Pastor Teresa and Apostle Robbie don't claim to know everything either. Amen. Amen. That's Apostle Taboo. That's one of the scriptures. Amen. So true. That he wrote there in there, he is talking about, I believe, in Romans 15. Let me go back up there because he kind of went up the screen. See, this thing keeps jumping. That's why I ain't used to this. But anyhow, it's Romans 10, 14 through 15. And it says, how then shall they call on him in whom they shall not believe? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent?
Amen.
As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace.
Praise God.
Glad tidings of good things. Amen.
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 It's obviously there that a lot of people, if they don't have no preacher to sit up underneath, and they just go into I call it a social club on Sundays where they gather and get a lecture or speaking, they're not going to know that they're and it's beautiful of those that preach the gospel. Your feet are beautiful, the word of God tells us. You know, you preach the gospel of peace and you bring in glad tidings and the blessings of the Lord you bestowing upon people so they can know how to walk worthy. How to, you know, to just know they call it too. Because a lot of people ain't gonna know they're calling in the church. They don't know. They don't know because they're not working in the church. And they can't work in the church because they don't know what it is to work in the church.
Good.
So, you know, I'm going to have to table this. I have some few more scriptures to go over. And then the next time I'll come, we'll be on because it's 8:02 and our time is winding up. But I just like to thank and praise God for each and all of you all for just coming out and being with us for another, you know, Bible study. But I just want to let y'all know we got to walk worthy according to the word of God. We have to hide thy word in our hearts that we may not sin
against God.
We just got to, we said all the different things that we talked about the characteristics of what
God expects.
Somebody walking it worthy. And we talked about the peace and everything and the love and walking harmoniously and all that. All that is foreign to somebody that don't know. That's foreign stuff to them. Because this world out here, it teaches you to,
praise God,
to do nothing but I'm going to get you before you got get me.
Yeah, I know. You're right.
And the example that we have in the world today, somebody coming into the church, they don't know to do right because all the world is teaching them is to do wrong.
Yeah. Very good.
So,
amen.
It's like we just have to, you know, have to get underneath sound teaching somebody that is really preaching the word of God, that's really sitting under the prophetic word. That's as Apostle Tabu has said. We have to sit underneath the prophetic word. And we're not sitting underneath the word, or we're not in the right atmosphere. The same way you come into the church, you're going to go back out. And yeah, we talked about
people don't want to get it,
but then there are people that do
want No change, no transformation.
So many people that don't want to change, but it's so many people that do want to change. Amen.
Amen for that.
God bless you all, and I just thank God. Before I close out, I do would like to give a little announcements here. Amen. Amen. God bless you. We ask that you all will come out this week. Thursday night, our prayer facilitator will be our very own Elder Marsha Jenkins, and that's at 7 p.m. And you can check our pages for that number, or either the group page. Any of the leaders have it posted on their page, or either, like I said, you can go to Soldiers on Fire for Christ, our group page, and you will get the number for the prayer call. Amen. And that's Thursday, February 15th at 7 p.m. And Elder Marshall Jenkins will be the prayer call facilitator. Next Friday night, we ask you to come and join our Apostle Robin Riley. She will be our instructor for that night. And if you would like to attend her class, just send her your email address via Facebook Messenger, and she'll be glad to let you be a part of that class by sending you a link to be a part of our Zoom virtual class. And that class, again, is at 7 p.m. Next Saturday, we will not have Bible study. But wait a minute. We are having the men and women panel discussion that afternoon. And that will be at 12 noon Eastern Standard Time. Amen. And we ask you to all just come out and join us. You can ask any of us and your email address, and we will make sure that you will get a link. When I say any of us, I'm talking about any of the administrative team. That's Pastor Teresa Denny, our Apostle Robin Riley, our Elder Marsha Jenkins, Minister Isaiah Robinson, Brother Bud Dillard, and myself. And we will be more than happy to give you the link so you can be a part of that great discussion. And that is next Saturday at 12 noon.
12.
Okay. Amen. And last but not least, we ask that you all to go to our pages, and you will find the St. Jude Foundation flyer. We have partnered with the St. Jude Foundation to stop out this evil demon that's trying to destroy our babies before their lives even get started. And there's so many children that are out there that are suffering, and their lives have not started yet, and it's because this demon called cancer is trying to destroy them. But we ask that you would partner with us as we partner with St. Jude to raise $1 million. The Lord has laid that amount on our Pastor Teresa's heart, and we can do it if we all just join together. I ask you to dig deep into your heart and dig deep into your pocket and give. Amen. When you go on to our pages, or either the group page, you will find that flyer with the little boy in the green shirt. And I tell you all the time, if you go all the way down, at the bottom of that flyer, it will have stjudesfoundation.org or stjudes.foundation.org, either one. And it says just because. If you just match on that, you will go directly to the St. Jude page, and that page will come up, and it has many suggestions. St. Jude is asking that we give a minimum of $5. So if you don't want to give those suggestions, I believe it's something like 30, 50, and 100. You can go all the way down to the bottom in the right-hand corner, and it has other. You can push on that and you can give the amount that you want. You might want to give more, praise God. And we welcome all amounts. We don't turn anything down because these babies need this. They need it for research. They need it for medication. They need it for the equipments and different things that they have to use. Amen? For their parents to have room and board to stay so they can be close to their children. So their parents don't have to worry about anything but to make sure they're there to comfort their child to get through this time. So I ask you, please, to dig deeply into your pockets. When you go down and you put in the amount you want to give and you push that done button, that money don't go to us. It goes straight to St. Jude, and St. Jude will send you an email message saying thank you for the amount that you have given. And if you give your information for your address for them to send things in the mail, they will send you little gifts like, mailing names for your name for you to put in your on your envelope to send out. They even got other little stickers like happy birthday, happy anniversary, little tabs and everything. They will send you these gifts for your monetary gift. And thanks, just to thank you for giving. Amen. So I'm asking you once again to dig deep into your pockets and help us to this worthy cause. Praise God. Praise God. And you don't have to give where my name can be on the list. You can give anonymous. That's what I want to get to. I had forgot that part. But, they will have your information to thank you for that. But you say you don't want your name on the list. They won't put your name on the list. So we're asking you to just give out of your heart. Give deep in your pocket. That little spare change that you had, you were going to go to McDonald's with. Or take that $5 plus something to go get a cup of coffee. Give to these babies. Go home and make you a cup of coffee. Go home and make you a sandwich. I'm sure you got something in there that you can to eat up quick. But I just thank you, and I ask you all to just govern yourselves accordingly to these announcements that have been given out. And we look forward to seeing you in our events. May God bless you. You all, let us pray out. If anyone have any other words or anything before I close out in prayer. If not, let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, oh, gracious God, we come to you all tonight. Lord, we just thank you, oh, God, for this Bible study class, oh, God. We thank you, Lord, and we pray, oh, God, that we have, oh, God, gleaned something from this class tonight that will help us, oh, God, along this journey, oh, God, that we may continue to walk worthy according to your calling, oh, God. That we may be, hallelujah, a living example to somebody else, oh God. Lord, help us, oh God, on tonight, oh God, that we may be all that we can be in you, Lord Jesus, Lord. That we will study to show ourselves approval, rightly dividing the word of truth. That we will hide thy word in thy heart, that we may not sin against thee, oh God. That others, oh God, can see you in us, hallelujah. And glorify the Father which is in heaven. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. That others may come to know you, Lord. I ask that you will even touch those, oh God, that will view this recording later, Lord. Open up their hearts and minds and of understanding, oh God. Lord, even those, oh God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. That may be a witness and a light to somebody, oh God. Let them, oh God, know the characteristics that they need to take on, oh God. Lord, help us tonight, oh God, that we may be, hallelujah, that all that you called us to be, oh God. And we thank you and we praise you and we glorify you, oh God. We ask that you will meet the needs of everyone that's on this line, oh, tonight, oh God. Lord, I ask that you will touch, oh God, those that may be having pain in their body, oh, tonight. Those, oh God. Hallelujah, glory to God, that has a decision, oh God, that they have to make, oh God. Oh Lord, hallelujah, those that have been, that reached the crossroads in their lives, oh God, I ask that you touch on tonight, oh God, that you will deliver on tonight and that you will set free on tonight, oh God. Lord, I thank you and I praise you, oh God, that we bind up every word, oh God, every enemy that comes to steal, steal, and destroy, oh God. Lord, I thank you and I praise you and I give you all the glory and all the honor and believing and trusting that you're going to be with us, oh God, until we come together again. Hallelujah. In Jesus' holy and righteous name. Amen, amen, and amen.
Amen.
Thank you all. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Lord. I thank God. Hallelujah.
Amen. Thank
amen.
You.
Amen. Amen. Excellent.